This video is sponsored by Great Courses Plus. There is probably nothing in all of science that's as jaw-dropping and confusing as the discipline of quantum mechanics. This is the set of physics theories that describes the behavior of subatomic particles. There's so much misleading information that has been written on this subject that for most people, it's very difficult to separate science facts from pseudoscience speculation. And given how important quantum mechanics is, for example, it's the basis of all modern microelectronics, from your cell phone, to your GPS, to your computer, to your solar cell, I think it's extremely important for you to be able to separate quantum physics facts from fiction. Let me give you a few examples of facts that you will read about, view, or be told. Quantum mechanics justifies free will because everything is random. Consciousness is a fundamental component of physics and the universe. None of these statements are supported by quantum mechanics. So what is quantum mechanics? And how does it actually work? And can it be explained simply in 10 minutes? The answer to that last question, I'm hoping you will agree, is yes. And the other answers are coming up right now. I hope to dispel the profound misunderstanding and misconceptions about quantum mechanics by explaining as simply as possible how quantum mechanics actually works, so you can judge for yourself when you're being told misleading information. I ask you to watch this video all the way through because if you go straight to the conclusions, I'm afraid you may still get the wrong ideas and be misinformed by people who would take advantage. So let's start with how quantum mechanics evolved. In 1801, British physicist Thomas Young performed a simple double-slit experiment, which showed that light was a wave, because it formed an interference pattern as a wave would. So for most of the 19th century, light was considered a wave. However, in 1887, German physicist Heinrich Hertz discovered something called the photoelectric effect. This is a phenomenon where light can knock off electrons from atoms. But it was found this phenomenon was not triggered by certain colors, regardless of the intensity of the light, but only by higher frequencies of the light. So ultraviolet rays resulted in this effect, but light at the red end of the spectrum did not, no matter how bright you made it. This was not the way a classical wave was supposed to behave. This mystery was solved by none other than Albert Einstein, who proposed that light was not a wave, but came in packets of energy, or particles. You know them as photons. These were packets of waves, he said, and the energy of these particles was proportional to the frequency of the wave. So higher frequency light corresponding to the blue and violet end of the visible scale carried more energy than lower frequency light corresponding to the red end of the spectrum. By the way, Einstein won the Nobel Prize for this. He did not win it for relativity. So Young and Einstein's results seemed to be in conflict. Was light a wave or a particle? But then, in 1909, G.I. Taylor performed a double-slit experiment such that only one photon was emitted through the double slits at a time. So what was seen on the screen? Well, if you shine a single photon through a double slit, you will see a single point on the other side. No mystery there. But then, as more and more photons are shot one at a time through the slits, and if you do this millions of times, a pattern emerges that looks like the same interference pattern that Young had demonstrated more than 100 years earlier. So individual photons look like particles, but a bunch of photons behave together like a wave. So photons appear to be both a wave and a particle. This was confusing. This experiment was later performed with electrons, which also showed the same pattern. But people were perplexed as to what a wave of an electron actually means. We can understand water waves because we can see them. They oscillate up and down. But what is actually happening with an electron? This was a mystery. In classical mechanics, Newton's second law, force equals mass times acceleration, makes a mathematical prediction regarding the path a physical object will take. If you know its initial conditions, you can always figure out where the object will be. Something that showed a similar mathematical description of the wave of electrons was needed. Something that showed the location of the electron or the shape of its wave function. In 1925, Austrian physicist Erwin Schrödinger invented the Nobel Prize-winning equation that revealed the shape of this wave function. It was the quantum mechanical equivalent of Newton's law, and it's probably the most important equation in quantum mechanics. We're not going to derive this formula, but I just want you to understand one thing about it. Unlike Newton's equation, it is not deterministic. It is not straightforward like Newton's equations. It evolves over time. The psi in the equation, which looks like a trident, is a wave function. Psi gives us the shape of the wave as a function of x. Schrödinger himself struggled with the interpretation of this wave function. That is, what does it actually mean? His interpretation was that it was the charge density of the electron over space. But this was actually not correct, and it did not work. In 1926, German physicist Max Born worked out that the psi function was related to probability. He said it represented the probability of finding the electron in any one point in space. So for example, this equation describes the behavior of electrons in an atom. It shows how the electrons occupy certain orbitals and what their shapes are. These shapes are really the probability densities of finding the electron in any particular spot. And unless you measure it, you can only come up with the probability of finding the electron at any particular radius. The most accepted interpretation of the wave function, called the Copenhagen interpretation, was pioneered by two of the founders of quantum mechanics, Werner Heisenberg and Niels Bohr. This interpretation says that until a measurement is made, this equation tells us that the electron is in all the potential positions at once. This interpretation basically says that the wave function is not a real thing. It only describes mathematical probabilities. The only thing that matters is the measurement. That is the only time when the position, energy, or other property of the particle can be known. So when the measurement takes place, that's when we say that its wave function has collapsed, because only at that point can we ascertain where the electron is and what its properties are. When it's measured, its probability becomes 100% where you measured it and 0% everywhere else. So for example, if the wave function for a particular system looks like this, the probability of finding the electron at this location and this location would be the highest, and here would be the lowest. But you won't really know where to find it until it's measured. And you're unlikely to find the electron in the same spot if you repeat the test. And this so-called collapse of the wave function is where the main confusion comes from when it comes to quantum mechanics. There's no equation that outlines exactly how this collapse occurs after measurement. This has been called the measurement problem of quantum mechanics. I've been careful to use the word measurement instead of observation, which many textbooks and physicists use interchangeably. The problem with the word observation is that it implies looking with your eyes, which requires an observer and a consciousness. But observation in quantum mechanics does not require eyes. It is simply a measurement. So what is a measurement? Doesn't it require a measurer? No, a measurement is an interaction of two physical systems. What does this mean? When an electron bounces off an atom, that's a measurement. An observation in physics does not mean a conscious observer. Just about anything can be an observation. If an atom in superposition interacts or bumps into another atom, it's an observation, and a wave function will collapse. When any two systems interact, that can collapse probability waves. There is no eyes, humans, or consciousness necessary. So let's get back to the double slit experiment and figure out what it means. When a single photon hits the screen, it collapses the probability wave of the photon. It shows up as a particle. That same photon is acting as a wave prior to hitting the screen because it hasn't been measured yet. The screen measures it. So as a wave, it has a non-zero probability to show up anywhere on the screen where the wave would strike the screen. So as we shoot thousands and millions of photons one at a time on the screen, the probability distribution becomes apparent in the pattern shown. If enough photons are fired, you get a distribution exactly as predicted by the wave function. Now, you saw in an earlier video I made about how the pattern changes to a double line pattern of photons instead of waves if we make the measurement of the photon before it strikes the screen. So knowing what I just told you about wave collapse, it should be obvious now why this double line pattern shows up. We are collapsing the wave by measuring it before it hits the screen. So now this photon is no longer in superposition. It is no longer a probability wave and not subject to the Born probability. So the photon is a distinct particle before it strikes the screen when it's measured and no longer behaves like a wave. So naturally, it's going to strike the screen and show a pattern like a particle would. The measurement made was a purely physical measurement. It would not matter if anyone or any animal looked at the measurement, or if someone took a photo of the measurement. All of that makes no difference in the collapse of the wave. Overall, what we can see is that the fundamental underpinnings of nature are probabilistic, not deterministic. Now, many have used this phenomenon to justify free will. Well, we have to be careful not to extrapolate what happens at the quantum level to the deterministic world of our everyday experience. Just because free will implies that your decisions are not deterministic, and quantum mechanics also implies that the properties of small particles are not deterministic, the two are not related. There is no science linking the two. We may or may not have free will, but quantum mechanics does not tell us anything about that. And consciousness is not required to collapse the wave function. The universe will exist and will continue to exist, whether we are here to observe it or not. Now, I have not covered everything in quantum mechanics, like quantum tunneling or entanglement. These are big subjects that I'll tackle in future videos. For now, I just wanted to convey the basics of how quantum mechanics works and dispel some of the common misunderstandings. Guys, I'm delighted to tell you that this video is sponsored by The Great Courses Plus. This is a subscription on-demand video learning service where you can enjoy lectures from some of the top professors and educators in the world. People like Dr. Don Lincoln of Fermilab, whose lectures I just watched on understanding the misconceptions of science. His lecture series was the inspiration, in fact, for this video. This particular course also covers some great topics that are of great interest to me, and they're going to be to you as well, like the science of aliens. Does thermodynamics disprove evolution? Can you go faster than light? If you want to get more in-depth knowledge on any of these subjects or what I discussed today, I highly recommend Great Courses Plus. Use the link in the description. Right now, Great Courses Plus is offering a free trial and a discount, but be sure to use this special link. And if you like this video, then please share it with your friends and give us a like. Also, if you have a question, post it below because I try to answer every one of them. I'll see you in the next video, my friends.